I will try to translate this the best I can. The physical jewels themselves are not as important as the metaphor of a jewel, the perfection to strive to achieve based on the pursuit of knowledge. We do not discriminate on country nor creed. All who are willing to achieve are welcome here. At least that's my take on it. The next puzzle is going to involve a blue hexagon. To anyone who's tried this game before, the phrase blue hexagon is probably terrifying. But do not worry, it's not that blue hexagon isn't terrifying. It is. It's because the phrase seventh mountain is even more terrifying, and that's the puzzle after this one, so you can save the sweat until then, please. Well, this is a nice-looking straighter room. There's some images on the wall, but I think this pool table in the middle is probably the more important thing. Well, we should probably climb up and get a better view of it by just going up this very, very safe-looking ladder. I don't think it's gonna fall at all. Okay. So, each of the different tiles has a different icon on it. And how many different icons are there, and what do these things do? Okay, turning a lever seems to turn a bunch of tiles by differing amounts in different directions, and they seem to be cycling through several different icons. Each one of these levers seems to be... Okay. Oh, okay, so you can turn the lever in one of two directions, and turning it back the other way undoes the move you just did. It looks like all these levers turn three different tiles. Yeah, every single one of these levers is turning in three tiles, so we're really screwed here in order to try to figure out how to... Oh, okay, now it only turns one tile. Well, if this is only turning one tile, maybe I can use this. So, I can go back and forth. Let's look. We have the oracle triangle, we have a cow, we have a palm tree. We have three compasses, we have water, we have a grating, we have the oracle again, we have a cow again, we have a palm tree again, three compasses, water, a grating, a triangle, the oracle. Okay, I think I made my point. So it seems like there's six different icons, and if I turn these other ones, I mean, they're turning in different directions, but you can kind of see, like, look up at that palm tree over there. It turns to cow, then it turns to triangle, which is, if we go here, we have triangle, cow, palm tree, so the direction was different, but they all go through the same icons.
Attentive study of the turning of the Divasah will prove that careful study leads to understanding. Only then can the power of prediction be the product of knowledge.
It sounds like he's saying that we should take a break from trying to solve this directly and start looking at this pen and paper and thinking about it.
There are many ways to prove your knowledge and wisdom.
That was some of the most useless advice I've ever received in my life. So, let's try... Alright. What we could do is each lever moves different tiles by differing amounts. If we could count up those amounts and build a listing of all the different moves available to us, maybe we can start to form a picture of how to move stuff around. So, what's the goal here? If we go across all this, let's say we have start at palm tree, we have cow, we have triangle, we have grating, we have water, we have compasses, and and then we're going to be back to the palm tree again. Maybe we need to repeat that order along the board, but the question is, which direction do we repeat it in, and where does it start from? Maybe I can make this a little bit more clear with pictures. What I've done is I went ahead and I've taken all the symbols in the order that they appear. I've picked an order. I could have picked going from palm tree, compass, water, grating, triangle, cow, but I decided to go the other way around. I also decided to start at the palm tree. These are arbitrary choices, just trying to get a grip of the puzzle, and assign them numbers. Now, no matter what I start with, this is the order that these icons are always going to appear. So it stands to reason that if there's 6 unique icons, and I started counting at 0, so because I'm a programmer and I have a habit of doing that. But the point is, there are 6 unique icons from 0 to 5, and there are 6 tiles on the puzzle. So my first guess would be that every tile needs to be different. And I would also then guess that if they all need to be different, and they'll appear in some order, maybe they need to appear in order. The only problem with this is that where do you start? The order of these tiles, the order of these icons, is also on the wall in the room. It's very difficult to see, but it still doesn't tell you where to start. Do you start at the top, on the side? What do I mean by where do you start? On this image, I've taken each of the numbers in the tiles, and I've arranged them as they are in the puzzle in what might be one possible solution. One possible solution might be going clockwise, palm tree, cow, oracle triangle thingy, grate, water, and compass. Now, that's one way of doing it, but what if we did it the other way? Anti-clockwise, or counterclockwise for people in America, we start at the palm tree, and then we go from anti-clockwise, cow, triangle, grating, water, and compass. Could that be another way of doing it? But why even start the palm tree at the top? Why can't we start it over here? Everything's been adjusted a little bit. Everything's been basically shifted, so that we still have the same order, but it's starting somewhere else. Now, when I first went for this puzzle, I decided to choose one of these. I believe it was the anti-clockwise one, and try to solve for it. And in my discovery, I found that actually all of the things I just shown are all solutions. So if you can go clockwise, starting at any location, then you have 6 unique solutions. And if you can go anti-clockwise, you have 6 more solutions for a total of 12 possible solutions for this puzzle. But the question now is, now that we kind of have a goal, we kind of have an idea of what we need to do, we now need to know how to do it. And with that, we need to look at the moves. I've pre-solved this puzzle, quote-unquote, with every single tile being the compass for demonstration purposes only. But I'm going to go through all of the different lever moves. And what's going to happen is that when a lever moves and it starts turning tiles, the tiles are going to move a certain number of times in a certain direction. Now, because I have chosen to represent the symbols from left to right with palm tree, cow, triangle, etc., I'm going to say that a movement from left to right, so to speak, where a tile, like saying going from cow to triangle or from going to compass to palm tree, would be a positive movement, and a turn going in the opposite direction would be a negative movement. And then the number will indicate how many times it moves. And what I'm going to do is, with this empty table here, I am going to fill that table with all the values necessary to enumerate every move possible in this entire puzzle. This will make it easy to, at a glance, see everything that's being capable of being done. And then from there, we might be able to start doing a little bit more work. Lest I leave you wondering what all those symbols on the table actually are referring to, this little annotated image shows that I've labeled each of the tiles with the uppercase L for location, and starting from the top, going clockwise, L sub 0, L sub 1, L sub 2, and so on. And for the bottom, for the moves, I've labeled each move lowercase m, sub 0, lowercase m, sub 1, and so on and so forth. Now, every move has an inverse. The standard move, what I will call just the regular move, will be the result of making the move using the right side of the lever. And the inverse of that move, representing the table with the letter I, will be by turning the left side of that lever. So with that, let's take a look at all of the moves available to us. All right, I'll walk you through the first example. So the compasses turn from the palm tree to the cow. Those turn from the water to the brazier grape thing. And then if I invert the move, they go back. So because of the fact that L1 moved to the palm tree, I'm going to say that that's a positive movement. And because L2 did not move to the palm tree, instead it moved to the grating after going through the water, I'm going to say that's a negative movement. Because both of those movements were a factor of 2, I'm going to say that that's a plus 2 and minus 2, respectively. The only other thing that was changed was L5 near the end, and that was only moved by 1. So the table is filled out like this for both the regular and the inverse. So we have our table of values. Now, it's time for the fun part, the chalkboard part. Basically, I'm going to recreate this table on the chalkboard, and we're going to go through how we can put some of these moves together to cancel each other out in ways such that we can form sets of moves that will make it easy to move only one tile at a time. This will help us to achieve our final ultimate goal. Here's the table again. We want to create sets of moves to move every single tile individually by one. It doesn't matter which direction, whatever move set we come up with, whatever combination of moves we come up with to move a single tile and by one. We can easily invert all of them individually to get the inverse of that move and turn it in the other direction. So let's finally actually start. M5 is going to be our baseline because it's the only move we currently have that only changes one tile by one direction. Sorry, not one direction, by one value. And we need to combine it somehow with all these other moves, and all these other moves move three tiles. There's no getting around that. There's no move that moved just two. So we're going to have to get a little bit creative here. But what does it mean to put moves together to cancel each other out? Well, the most obvious is that two moves back to back that move the same location in opposite directions by the same amount, in other words, goes down to zero, won't move it at all. So for example, if I was to move M1, L2 would be moved by one in positive direction. Can't remember if that's clockwise or anti-clockwise. And if I move M5, then it'll be moved in the other direction, which is the same as if it wasn't moved at all. So combining M1 with M5 means that I only change L0 by 3 and L1 by 1. But that's not what we're going for. We want something better than that. So that's not going to work on its own, but that illustrates the concept. The second concept is, might not be as obvious, but it's very important. We have 6 different icons, and the Divasah thingy, table, whatever, goes through each icon in the same order and then reverts back to the beginning. In other words, it's like they're in a circle. So after palm tree, you've got cow after cow, you've got oracle after oracle, you've got drain after drain, you've got water after water, you've got 3 compasses. After 3 compasses, you've got palm tree again. Or if you go in the opposite direction, you get to go to palm tree and then you go to 5 compasses. I'm pretty sure that's not what the icons actually represent, but I like palm trees. So yeah, what this means is that any move that moves something by 6 or 12 or 18 or -6 or any multiple of 6 also cancels it out. For example, moving M1 by 2, that is going to make no difference to L0. L0 will be moved by 3, will be moved by 3 again, it'll end up back where it started, even though it's moving in the same direction all the time, because the icons are arranged, if you think of it like this, as a ring. You're always moving in one direction or the other, but you're never actually reaching an end, which is good. It makes things easier for us. But if we were to do that, we'd end up with a -2 here and a +2 here. And even if we got rid of L2 with M5, we'd still be moving only one tile, but by 2. That's not our goal. We want to move one tile by 1, not by 2. So we're going to have to be a little bit more creative here. There is math in this, but a lot of it has to do with just feeling around. Now, I've already done this, so I already know what I'm doing. At least I hope I do. When you first start with this, you're going to probably be playing around with a bunch of different, or you're just going to be cheating and using what I did, different ways, and then coming up with them your own way. But I'm just going to skip ahead to what I already found out, and that is that if you take M3, for example, and you move it by 3, you can see here that these 2s are going to cancel out, because moving them by 3 is going to move them to 6. So with L1 and L5 moved by 6, it's going to be like they weren't even moved at all. All you're going to be left with is 3 of L0. And 3 of L0 is, by a striking coincidence, the same amount in the opposite direction that M1 is going to change it. So by doing it this way, we're going to cancel out L0 from M1 without actually having to mess these two up like we did earlier with the two moves of M1 example. So they're both still at 1, and then we can apply M5 to get rid of it. Let's actually start writing stuff down. All right, so we're moving this by 3. So we have 3 of M3. And we're going to combine that with an M1 move.
Now let's just stop there and write what we have. That is going to be equal to a negative L1 move and a positive L2 move. All right, so now that we have the negative L1 move and the positive L2 move, this is like an intermediate step. We can then say how we got to get rid of one or the other. Well, L2 can easily be gotten rid of with M5, so let's add it. We have a positive L2. We want to get the negative L2 from M5, so they cancel to 0. So we're going to just add the regular M5 to that. That makes 3M3 plus M1 plus M5 is equal to... And we have it. Of course, I would probably reorder them so it's M1, M3, M5. But the basic gist is there. If you go into the disfog thingy, turny, multi thingy... already solved one of them. We have not only determined a way of just changing one tile on its own, but in a sense we have a new tool in our toolbox. When we look at this and we try to match them up to cancel things out, we can be a little bit more sloppy now and leave L1 to some value that we can cancel out later and then just plug this in. And this doesn't just work with only one move of L1. If, for example, we need to get rid of L1 by moving it by 2. You could just multiply this whole thing out by 2. And you could probably notice that because of the 6 here, you don't have to move M3 at all. And then 2 of M1 and 2 of M5 would be negative 2 of L1. And you could do that for however much you need to move L1 to fix things up. So you can, that's, you know, helpful. But we don't need to go there yet, because there's actually another trick we can do, which is up to here, to get us L5 by itself. Excuse me. Earlier, we mentioned that M1 moved twice, would cancel itself out with respect to L0 because the 3 would turn into a 6. But we'd be left with 2s here, and we could cancel one or the other out, but we'd still be left with 2. But we can also do this. We can cancel both out, and then whatever cancels them out adds only one of another move. Let me show you. Moving M1 by 2, it's going to give us, let me just actually write that out, since there's no L0 anymore, it's going to be negative 2 of L1 and positive 2 of L2. Now, we notice that M0 up here, the regular one, not the inverted one, conveniently perfectly cancels that out, but it adds its own thing. But that doesn't matter. In fact, that's good, because by adding its own thing is now the only thing. So if we were to add the M0 to that whole system, the positive 2 L1 here would cancel the negative 2 L1 there. The negative 2 L2 here We'll cancel out the positive 2L2 here, and all that's left is the positive L5 that was just moved in. So, M0 plus 2 of M1 equals L5. Let's confirm that. Seen that that works, which means we have made two moves. We found out two composite moves that move respectively L1 and L5 by only one. And we can always decide which direction we want to do by inverting every move individually. So now we've gotten down three. We just need three more. And this is where we hit the last ride of the day. We can figure out L0. It's a little bit more complex, but it's doable. The problem is L3 and L4 are not. They're paired with other moves, but they always move together, like they're in some kind of polyamorous relationship. So if we move M2, then L3 and L4 are going to be moving together. So whatever icons they show, they're not going to change relative to each other, which isn't particularly helpful most of the time. M4 is a little bit better. -1 and +1 means they move opposite to each other, so you can change how they are relative to each other. Because they're directly next to each other, they both, one needs to directly follow the other in the icon chain. So if we have to keep using this and only this in order to get that to that point, this would not help us. Let me show you. That's why I actually drew this thing out. This is the palm tree. This is the supposed to be a cow, but in my drawing it's going to be referred to as blob. The oracle, the grating, the water, and the compasses. This is the order that they appear. So if let's say, for instance, we start with...
Just a quick brief intermission. What I have on the chalkboard is not representative of the actual hexagon, blue hexagon tile puzzle thing. You know, when you look at it from above, even though it looks like it is, what it's representative of is instead the symbols I showed earlier, but instead of being in a line, I've put them in a ring in accordance with the fact that as they turn, they keep looping over the same icons over and over again in a different direction. So what I'm referring to when I refer to L3 and L4, I'm referring to the locations here marked L3 and L4, but this circle here on the chalkboard is not representative of the actual puzzle. When you look at it, it's representative of the order of the symbols as you're rotating them. So when I explain moving around, I'm explaining those two tiles moving, changing symbols in accordance with that order that's presented there. Just thought I'd point that out because it can be kind of confusing given that on the chalkboard, it's pretty much put in the same locations as the tiles on the puzzle, which can create the appearance that I'm referring to something that I'm not.
The blue arrows represent the starting points for, like, say, L3 and L4. So if we start with L3 being a palm tree and L4 being the grating, then moving M4 plus 1 minus 1 means they're going to be moving in opposite directions. Whereas moving this means it could be moving in the same direction. So if they're moving in the same direction, ding, 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 ding. And then again. So there's only three unique situations they can be in, and they don't change relative to each other. And they need to be close together. They need to be one after the other in order for the puzzle to work out. So we'd use the other one. They move in opposite directions now. Here, then they swap. Here, here, then they swap. So in this instance, for example, it is impossible for, so we have water, compass, and we have cow or blob and triangle, but we can't have, say, palm tree and cow, because there's no way that's gonna work out. We just can't do it. We could probably move them by two and then invert it. That might work, but actually that could work. But the point I'm trying to make is that we're a little bit limited. There's only gonna be a certain subset of possible icons, that combinations we can use with these two, because we can't isolate them. And that's not the worst part. This just means that of all the different solutions that you can have, and you can have clockwise, you can have anti-clockwise, you can have it starting anywhere as long as they're in the same order, you're restricted to only a small subset of those. But what's worse is if the puzzle itself generates a slightly different way. Now, moving M4 is going to move them to be the same thing. And if you try the other direction, they're going to be moved to the same thing. And if you go by two and then move it, they're still going to become the same thing. There's never going to be a situation, if the puzzle generates in a way like this, which can occur probably half the time, where L3 and L4 are going to be in a situation where one of them can be set to an icon and the other one can be set to the next icon. It's just not possible. And you can tell this by constantly moving M4 until you see that they become equal, that L3 and L4 have the same icon on their faces. If that happens, if constantly moving M4 shows you those two tiles being the same thing, you're fucked. This puzzle will generate unsolvable situations. There's nothing you can do about it. If that happens, you can't just reset the puzzle. Resetting the puzzle with the little bar thingies at the top only resets it to the permutation it had when it started. In other words, the beginning when you first got there. If you want to actually change how the puzzle is generated, you have to walk away from the puzzle, climb back up the ladder, look back down at it, and then it will regenerate. So with this, we've discovered an important rule. The moment you get to the puzzle, you've got to move this handle and keep moving it. If you see two of the same thing, restart the puzzle. If you never see the same thing, try to get it set up in such a way that you end up with one icon followed by another. In other words, solve L3 and L4 first. You have to. There's no other way around it. Once you've done that, you can then solve the remaining things, which brings me to the final point. That makes L0 the only one we have left to discover. So let's try that now. All right. So we're on the last one, the last ride of the day. We need to isolate L0. We already know for a fact that L3 and L4 have to be solved at the beginning of the puzzle. We have ways to solve L5, L2, and L1 independently. All that's left is L0. And why not? Let's use the composite moves we've already solved, put them together, and see if we can use them with the primary moves to get a solution for just L0. Now, what are we going to choose as our base? There are three moves that move L0. There's M4, M3, and M1. M1 can go get screwed because it's only going to move it by three. And if we move it again, it's going to be moved by another three, which will make it as if it wasn't moved at all. So there's no way to get this to become just one. So it goes bye-bye. This one, as we've already established, we cannot modify L3 and L4. We've already done that. So that's not going to help us. That leaves M3. M4. I think I said M4. Yeah, M4 is the one that's bad. That leaves just M3 as the remaining one that we can actually use. So let's write that out. If we use M3, we're going to be moving L0 by 1. We're going to be moving L1 by 2. And we're going to be moving L5 by -2. By a startling coincidence, we have L1 and L5 already written. By coincidence, I mean I wrote them ahead of time. But we've already solved for them. So all we gotta do is plug those in to get rid of L1 and L5. The signs are right. This is negative, that's positive. This is negative, that's positive. Both will cancel out properly. The only thing that's not right is the value, but the value is easily correctable. If we want to move L1 in the negative direction by 2, just multiply all these moves out by 2. So 2 of M1, 6 of M3, 2 of M5. Let's go ahead and do that. All right, so start with our base, M3. We want to add this. We want to do this move twice. So that will be 2 of M1, 6 of M3, and 2 of M5. We want to move this one. We want to do this one twice. That will be 2 of M0, 4 of M1. Now, you could just leave it like this and be like, okay, let's remove L0, that'll be just fine. Or you can simplify it down so that you don't want to be horrifically scared every time you have to move L0 by 1. So, let's take a look. We have 6 of M3. We don't need 6 of M3. It's going to do nothing anyway. We have another M3 term, thankfully, which makes sense because it has to move by 1 somehow. We have 2 of M1 and 4 of M1. Together, they become 6 of M1, also cancels. That leaves us with, let me write it in order, 2 of M0. Let me write it in order in bigger font. 2 of M0 plus M3 plus 2 of M5 will get us what we wanted originally, L0 being moved on its own. Let's confirm that. Session over. We've done. So, game plan. A, L3 and L4. B, and this depends on how you want to do it, you can choose to holistically move the other ones to try to get one of the other tiles done, and then use the algorithms we found out to solve the remaining ones once you can't move one without messing up ones that are already solved. That's like a combination of holistically and then moving to logic once you don't want to mess stuff up anymore. I guess kind of like a Rubik's Cube. Actually, this puzzle is very similar to a Rubik's Cube in that you are trying to make a series of destructive changes that cancel each other out, except for what you wanted originally. All right. One more thing. When you're actually solving the puzzle, don't just blindly make these moves. Like, for example, if you have to move L0 by 3 spaces, don't just blindly go, okay, 2 of M0, M3, 2 of M5, all right, 2 of M0, M3, to M5, to it, and then again, blah, blah. Pen and paper it out first. If you multiply this whole thing out by 3, this becomes 6 of M0, and that becomes 6 of M5. They cancel. You just have to move M3 3 times, which makes sense, because if you look back up here at what M3 is originally, you'll see that moving it by 3 cancels these out anyway. So, always pen and paper out it if you're going to do something other than an obvious, like, 1 or 2 move, because you never know. You might be able to make that move in fewer steps.
All right, let's try actually solving this. First things first, let's make sure we're not in an unwinnable situation. We're not. They just passed each other. They're not going to be equal. Good. So, we have cow and triangle, and that is the order to go around anti-clockwise. If we switch it around, we can go clockwise. So, I'm actually going to switch it back and decide to go anti-clockwise. So, if that's cow and that's triangle, then that means that before cow has to be palm tree. Let's ignore the one that can move on its own anyway and focus on that. Now, we could start the move set for L5 to get it to be a palm tree. Or we can just move it to be a palm tree right now because, oh, whoops, I went the wrong way. I don't want to have to go around the whole way. I'm just going to turn that back. There's no reason to worry about making the actual move set that doesn't damage L1 and L2 because we haven't solved L1 and L2 yet. So don't worry about them. Now we want to change L0. So L0 is going to need to be the compasses. Let's try to make it a compass then. Our algorithm for L0, as you recall, I hope you wrote it down because I didn't. Remember, it's currently a grate and we need it to be for 3 compasses. So we have to use our L0 move twice in the positive direction. So we multiply the whole thing out by 2 and double up all of our moves. Completes the algorithm, except there's one extra little thing we can do here. We're already done. We didn't even have to worry about L1. It just accidentally ended up in the right place. Sometimes Cave Johnson gives you lemons. So in that entire, with all the work we did, we only had to do the algorithm we made for L0. If you play your cards right, you usually only have to use 1 or 2 of the algorithms you discovered, and you can holistically solve one of the other ones. So let's grab that jewel and get out of here. If it wasn't for the fact that sometimes this generates unsolvable situations, this would be probably my favorite puzzle. It gives me the most satisfaction to have solved it, and its difficulty is hard, but it isn't impossible. The fact that it generates unsolvable situations puts a blemish on an otherwise good puzzle. I liked having to figure out the solution and apply these mathy mechanics to get it. It's tough, but it's not impossible. The impossible is what the fucking seventh mountain puzzle is, the one we have to solve after this. But first, let's enjoy the soothing sound of the oracle.
The tasks resolved so far marked here are 22. Foundation spring of purest symmetry. Emblem of the earth and city, this well converges place and divisions of time. An almanac, register of the days. Six houses, 6 days. Five markers, 5 weeks. These blocks be symbols of significance. 12 times 30 days hath Khandra's portion. 12 times the night sky she crosses per year. Such wisdom as the scholar seeks to mind, within this house of Sastram shall you find.